We are very excited to welcome Gabrielle Fidis to our Alumni Career Chat series today. And Gabrielle is joined today by members of our career development team, including myself, Tegan O'Connor, Employer Relations Coordinator, our director, Megan McCarzik, our Assistant Director for Student Employment, Manqing Tom, and our Office Coordinator, Olivia Marriott. Gabrielle graduated from Manhattanville in 2016 with a degree in dance and theater. And during her time on campus, she was a member of Manhattanville's Dance Ensemble. She was also actively involved in the Clark Center, formerly Duchesne Center, and their community service programs, and worked on campus in the dance and theater department. And Gabby is currently back in the classroom as a full-time student and also intern, and she's working towards her master's degree in drama therapy at New York University. So thank you so much, Gabby, for taking the time to speak with us today about your time at Manhattanville and your career journey so far.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. I'm really happy to be here. When I saw the prompt, I think it was either an email or Instagram or something, I was like, I feel like I have something to offer because fun fact, the Department of Dance and Theater used to have a drama therapy concentration, but it phased out before I even got there. And so I think it's interesting in a circle of events that I ended up studying drama therapy somewhere down the road, even though it wasn't at Manhattanville, but it all started there anyway.
So with that being said, you know, you are currently, you're back in the classroom. Holy smokes. Many of us know that feeling all too well. So can you take a moment to describe your experience thus far in your drama therapy master's program at NYU? Mm-hmm. What motivated you to pursue this field? And then what types of job opportunities you'll be going for when you complete your degree?
I would have to say being back in the classroom, especially back in September, was sort of a out-of-body experience of, oh my God, I'm a student again. This is so weird, but it also just clicked right back in that being back, it wasn't that long since I graduated. So I think the muscle memory was like, yeah, we're in academia again. So this is easy. We can do this. And I would have to say it's been a journey. And even separate from COVID-19, even the fall semester, this program is very, it's rigorous in a different way that I think I was prepared for, but it's something that you don't know until you're physically in it, because the studying of drama therapy takes so much of you as a person. It's not so much just learning psychology and then going and being a therapist. It takes a lot of internal reflection before you can start asking others to reflect with you. But it's been wonderful, and it's always feeling like the place I need to be. And that's kind of what brought me there too. I thought before I refound drama therapy that I wanted to teach theater. I got really turned on to theater education my junior year of college and started kind of making moves that supported that dream. But then somewhere along the line, I was teaching musical theater at post-grad and was going to take a position as a teacher, which would have led to theater teacher. And it just didn't feel right. It wasn't sitting correctly somewhere inside me. It just, you know, it was that gut feeling that it was going to be the wrong choice. And I'm so glad that that happened, because within a 2-week span of turning down a job as a teacher, I had a phone call with my professor, Mark Beauregard, who taught drama therapy. And we spoke for an hour about my wanting to reconnect with it. And then I was on track to apply to NYU. And it was just the right thing. It was such kismet. It was like the fates were like, no, don't teach. Go do drama therapy. And I did not question it. And I still don't question it, because it feels like the right path that I have finally found to be on.
What were some of the most defining events or opportunities or aspects of your time at Manhattanville?
There were so many, which I am so privileged to say. I feel like a lot of my Manhattanville experience is always influencing my life now, which I think is wonderful. I would have to say something that definitely influenced was setting the foundation for drama therapy was my work with the Clark Center, the formerly Duchesne Center. I worked with a program called Speak and another called Touch of Theater. Speak was more developed than Touch of Theater. Touch of Theater was kind of one that came and went, but my friend and I co-coordinated these two groups on a weekly basis. We were the student coordinators, and it was just such amazing work. I had never done anything like that before. The speak participants were so wonderful. I got to know so many of the kids, and even working with the shelter workers was a really valuable experience of getting to speak to them, and just using theater as a tool to play with these kids and to engage with them. And then I realized when I got to NYU in my program that I was basically doing drama therapy work, that a group like that is something that a drama therapist might start. And so it was this like backwards experience of, oh, wow, I've already been doing that. And that's awesome. And I think that's where I got confused about maybe I want to teach, but it turned out I just want to use theater intentionally to help people learn skills, to just learn to play, to engage with peers, which is something that the participants of Speak seem to really need, just this informal engagement with each other and a place to safely just be silly and be kids and, and reclaim that experience, because so many of them were so young, but they came in like little adults. And I was like, come on, guys, let's be goofy. And so it was just such an amazing experience. I always call back to it in my program. And yeah, I would definitely say it was a foundational element of the drama therapy journey.
And so you just talked about the Clark Center and that, how that sort of helped guide you in the direction of drama theater. Were there any other ways that Manhattanville helped to prepare you for a career path in drama therapy?
I would say my answer is like twofold. The dance and theater department specifically, I think, sets a really good, just good groundwork for students, because of the fact that while the curriculum is very much almost like a BFA, it's within the BA program. And so just like the liberal arts modality of Manhattanville, the dance and theater department has its program set up so that you're not just learning acting and dancing specifically, just these fine art performance-based classes. It's very much focused on creating as much of a well-rounded arts professional as possible. So I took classes in stage management and directing and playwriting and scene design and the technical aspects like lighting design. I worked in the scene shop, so I can physically build a set. If I was on a team, I know how to use a chop saw. And then in addition to the dance and theater specific program classes, and, you know, even in that, there were literature based classes like the Survey of Dramatic Literature, two part, to basically learn the history of theater and the literature of theater from the ancient Greeks all the way up to today. And I think that coupled with my non-drama dance and theater classes just gave me such a great experience, because I took psychology classes, I took marketing classes, I took all these different things that never made me think I was only going to be an actor. There was so much non-acting happening that within myself as an artist, I was also just a budding human who felt like I could choose anything, because of the fact that I was not just being told, you're going to act and that's it. The program is extremely realistic and sets us up not for failure, but for the realism of the career. And some people do go on to perform. Absolutely. I have classmates who are professional performers and I'm so excited for them. But somewhere down the road, I found, yeah, I don't want to be an actor. And I'm really excited that my program didn't feed me that the whole time and say, yeah, acting's the only thing. So I think that's really important. And the support of the faculty has been extremely just makes us successful graduates of the program.
And then what associations, clubs, or resources at Manhattanville aided you in your professional development?
I would definitely say 100% the Clark Center. I've been doing community service since I was allowed to, preteens are able to do community service. And so being a part of that just felt like home, and it felt really natural to me to find as many things that I wanted to participate with. So I think that just solidified me as a global citizen, as a socially active and socially aware citizen. I kind of always try to approach life, even if it's not community service based, in terms of how can I help the most people, which I guess, how did I find drama therapy? I just want to help as many people as I can using the thing that I love. I also think being a part of the PET program with Hannah Fox, that was in the fall to spring of 15 to 16. I was in her one class, her playback class, and then the special performance class that she created out of this idea, and then got to see the inaugural performance of the pet performance for the incoming freshmen. And that was a really valuable experience because, again, that it was basically drama therapy, what we were doing, because playback theater is actually something that falls under the umbrella of drama therapy a lot of the time. And so getting to work so close with Professor Fox and getting to collaborate on this project and having it have this social justice content within it, it just felt like such a blend of all of the things that I was learning and the things I was going to do when I was already a graduate when we performed it. So it was like this really nice first step into my life as a professional. And I hope it, you know, had an impact on the people who saw it, because we tried to cultivate it so that it was informing incoming freshmen about these important things that maybe get glossed over in the, you know, entryway into college. I think it had more weight to it, and we tried to hit those important notes a little harder than maybe people feel comfortable doing. You know, they're like, well, it's a really serious topic. And so that's what our point was. We wanted to really hit home those really important topics that college freshmen kind of, you know, laugh about and brush off their shoulders, and then it becomes a problem. And it's almost like they're not set up to successfully address those problems. So we wanted to use this theater piece as a theater educational tool to, you know, pepper in some jokes, but also there were really important lessons underneath in the subtext of what we were saying and the literal text of what we were saying.
I love that. I think that's so great because, you know, usually when it comes to those types of conversations, the immediate, you know, feeling is, oh, it has to be a lecture. There needs to be PowerPoint slides. They need to see it and hear it. But when it's acted out in a real life scenario, you're able to associate with it and it resonates with you and it stays with you. So I think that's really fantastic. And then to be able to, so 15, 16, you graduated in 16. So then they saw you and your fellow pet performers on campus and they're like, oh, you're real. So it adds another layer of seeing someone on campus that they know of, that they've seen. So I think that's really fantastic. And I think that's, I mean, both you, actually you and Olivia are on the same like bar, and I know you guys are both pet performers, so I'm like, oh, that makes sense. I love that. So looking back, whether it, you know, involves Manhattanville or your post-Manhattanville life, what have been the most challenging and the most rewarding moments thus far?
I would say I feel like the most challenges happened after graduation, which I think would make sense, because that was the no more structure time and the future was pretty much up to me. And I think with the post-grad journey, but I think they were challenges that I would go through again. Maybe not the specific ones, but just the energy of these challenges. I would definitely say my early work experience, pretty much up until I went back to school, it was just all of these experiences that just were teaching me different things and kind of shoving me away from that direction. I always feel like the things that I do are for a purpose, even if I'm not sure of what it is at the time. I think going through that challenging work experience gave me a different kind of resilience, because it's hard on the self-esteem and the ego, especially for a theater major who already lives deep in the stigma of like, well, you have a theater degree, so that's what you paid for. But I felt like there was something I had so many skills that were not just acting that I felt I had so much to offer, and I just had to find where I could offer it. And so I, you know, first had just survival jobs and then ended up finding a job. Like I mentioned, I was teaching musical theater and I was assisting the director of a dance studio and got to do pretty much what dance and theater taught me, all of those things. I was stage managing for the director. I was basically the assistant director. I was the stage manager for the performances. I was teaching the kids and I was, you know, coaching them one-on-one on their scene work because I had taken acting where we worked on scene work. So I knew how to translate that from adult acting to how can I tell this 10-year-old how to find an objective and to have a purpose for what you're saying and to, you know, do character analysis. And so there was all of this, you know, dramaturgy. And I even helped write the script for the children's show because they were adapting it. And so it was all of these things that I got to do. This position happened kind of in the middle of my job experience. And so it almost felt like a reminder that I had skills and that my love of theater was something that I could be successful at. I just didn't know what yet. And even that job was challenging just because, you know, there was creative differences. There's always creative differences in the arts. Despite the struggles that I had with that job, that was like a stepping up point, like a reclaiming of myself point almost. Then in the midst of having a different job, it was another survival job. It was in the midst of that job that then I realized I needed to do drama therapy. And so it was a challenging, I think it was between 2016 and 2018 that I was working and then ended up applying. And so it was that 2 year span that felt like 10 years, let me tell you. At the end of that 2 years, I found what I needed to find. And so I don't disparage having that experience and going through those challenges, because it was just kind of the beat up I needed from the world. I was a very idealistic college graduate who felt like the world was my oyster. And I still have that idealism, because I think it still is. But it just, you know, beat the child out of me almost. I think college graduates feel so invincible and like these powerful adults. Like, I have a bachelor's degree and I can do anything, but I still needed to learn about, you know, the getting beat up part. And so I think I got that, but it led me to where I am now. And I always look back at it with gratitude and understanding of the why it happened. It didn't beat me down completely. It just, you know, beat the ego out of me a little bit.
So I think, you know, there's a lot of times where when we're working with students, and especially once they've graduated, where, you know, Manhattanville is a small community, so you can find your niche very easily. And even if you go to a large institution, when you get out into the real world, that scary monster, it is a matter of earning your stripes. But I will say, sometimes it's those survival jobs that are what kick you in the butt or teach you how to thrive, where it's no longer a survival job, but it's like, oh, I can do this, but I know what I want to do. You know, whether it's an aha moment or just a kismet, we'll go with a movie term, a drama term, a meet cute. You know, you could be waitressing or hosting, and you meet someone and you are like, what do you, they mention what they do, and it's a conversation. So there's always opportunities to get out there. And I'm so glad that you were able to have that moment and continue to have these moments to say, okay, I'm no longer a kid. I'm going to go out into the real world, or I'm going to thrive in the real world. Mm-hmm. And you said, kind of took that moment of reflecting backwards and saying, thank you, community service. Thank you, Duchesne, now Clark, whatever. Thank you, Manhattanville. I'm going to have a conversation. I'm going to go to NYU. So I love that.
That is so true. I mean, what Megan said, and Gabby, what you say is just right on the money, in terms of, you know, sharing with our students. It's a great takeaway for them, because everybody has a different path of getting to where you want to go. And like you said, everything you do has a purpose, whether you're conscious of it or not. Mm-hmm. And that's okay. And we always impress upon our students that, you know, it's a journey, and everybody has a different way of getting to our destination. Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, absolutely fine. And you know, and eventually you will get there sooner or later. Can you share with us who would you consider to be your influencer or someone that you look up to?
I mean, I have so many. Just really, they're mostly educators, because I feel like those have been the people who have been my best cheerleaders over my experience of being in undergrad and now in my graduate program. I would definitely have to say, in my Manhattanville experience, some of them aren't even dance and theater mentors, but just people that I felt like saw a strength in me that maybe I didn't recognize in myself. That is even something, you know, I look back fondly of now as an adult in the real world. I would have to say, dance and theater wise, you know, I like I mentioned Mark Beauregard before. He's not on the faculty right now, but he was my intro to drama therapy professor. He is a drama therapist. He practices right now. And so I felt like he's always been a mentor to me. He, you know, he introduced it to me first. He kind of started this journey and then spoke to me on the phone multiple times during my application process. He wrote me a recommendation letter for NYU. He's been integral to this entire experience. And I even had the fortune of taking his class this past spring semester. He was on the faculty of NYU as an adjunct. And so I was really excited that kind of got to come full circle, that I got to be in his class again. So I learned so much from him all the time, just about drama therapy. And we have the Manhattanville connection. He didn't attend the school, but, you know, just working here, he knows the vibe and the energy that Manhattanville brings. I would also say in the drama therapy program, I don't think that she's on faculty either, but I had Carol Fox Prescott, who taught some classes and was my director twice in the drama in the dance and theater program. And she kind of gave me a resurgence of myself as an actor, as a person, as a creator, because she was my first real production at Manhattanville in the dance and theater program. And this was a time when, you know, I was very insecure about my abilities and about my belongingness in the program. And doing that show with her just changed my perspective and gave me the self-confidence that I needed in myself, which kind of just kicked off my experience in the program from then on. You know, sophomore year was a very tumultuous time. I feel like it is for a lot of college students. Sophomore year is just like a weird space in being a college student. And so working with her was so great. And I consider her to be one of my mentors now as well as in college. We talk a lot. And so she's someone whose wisdom I always carry with me. Non-dance and theater professor that I had the pleasure of taking their class at Manhattanville, Professor Lugowski in the film studies department. I took his film topic class my junior year, and I think it was my senior year, and it was his horror film class, and it was a thing that I love to do. I love to sit and analyze horror movies, but he always had such wonderful feedback to my papers and showed me that I was good at analyzing things and had a good head on my shoulders, and is just a lovely person to take class with. So I urge anyone to take Professor Lugowski's classes, because he's just a joy. And I absolutely loved sitting in his class and conversing with him. I feel like he made me smarter all the time, just in terms of talking about film. But he saw an academic strength in me that I think was a great reminder that in addition to being an artist, I also am someone who is very intelligent. And, you know, because that, again, that stigma of, well, you're an actor, so you must not be that smart. It's like, well, no, I took a lot of these classes that showed that I was and am extremely intelligent. And so breaking that stigma and showing non-arts professors that, you know, the dance and theater students are intelligent people. So, and he brought that out in me, and I just had an absolute wonderful time watching horror movies with Professor Lugowski. And I think right now, in terms of influences, the director of the NYU program never fails to bring me some kind of inspiration or joy. Dr. Nisha Sajnani, she is truly has been a guiding light right now, especially with COVID. She is the beacon at the forefront of the drama therapy ship that is absolutely necessary. I feel like she can't say anything that's not effective. Even just a very simple hello feels like it has so much weight to it. And I just am so inspired by her. Her work as a drama therapist is amazing. Her work as a scholar in the drama therapy world is so effective. And she basically has a partnership with every, you know, foundation and group that drama therapy should. She does a lot of work with the WHO. She does a lot of work with drama therapy associations around the world. And she is just, I think she's a true trailblazer and pioneer in the drama therapy world. She's always working and always thinking of ways to make things better. And so I kind of strive to be at least a little bit like Nisha. I don't think I can be her, because she's like a titan, but she's just such a joy to work with and have as the director of the program. I think she's the reason why I wanted to apply for the program. I met her at a meet and greet and I was like, I'm sold. You don't have to tell me twice. I want to hang out with Nisha.
Thank you so much. So I feel like you've given us such great advice for our students so far, sort of about trusting the journey and also trusting that gut feeling or that instinct, like you knew that the teaching field wasn't for you. What do you consider to be the most useful piece of career advice that you've received so far on your journey?
I'm not sure if I've ever received any specific statements that, you know, have stuck out to me. I think my notion of career advice has just come from the messaging of different people I've worked with and just sort of the unspokenness of a job. And I think I definitely want to call back just the notion that career-wise, through dance and theater, I was never once told, you know, believe that you're going to be an actor. Like, this is the one track. I think Professor Ara Fitzgerald, I once had a meeting with her for advising, and, you know, she kind of asked me, what else would you want to do? And I think that was a perspective check as a student in the middle of my journey that, yeah, I might not be an actor. Putting that realism into my brain and setting me up to start thinking about it before it was senior year and before I graduated and all I had was, I'm going to be an actor. And I think I always appreciated Ara's extremely down-to-earth and grounded feelings about the profession, because, you know, she is and has been a professional dancer and deviser her whole life and her whole career. But she was also a great example that's not for everyone. And, you know, even she's an educator now. And so you can change what you do. And so I think just having Professor Fitzgerald as a model was the best career advice, because she just never supported the imaginary land of a theater degree that is only acting and only dancing, that performance isn't what makes an artist, that you can still be an artist in many different ways, and you can have little bits and pieces of different things that support your art, but they're not you just following one way, that there's so many different paths that you can take but still call yourself an artist. And so I think I've always held that with me, and it has kept me grounded, that I always consider myself an artist because I'm a creative being. I create things. I still perform in a community theater background. Yeah, I still consider myself to be an artist, even though I'm not a professional actor. And I think that was something important that Ara instilled in me, sort of subconsciously. You know, she didn't just specifically tell me, but it's just something I always picked up from her.
Yeah, I love that's like the internal, your internal compass saying, what am I, like, that's your true north. If you're tapped into your artistry and your creativity, then you know you're doing something right. Mm-hmm. I think that's part of just listening to that inner voice. And it's true. Like, my gosh, last week, 2 weeks ago, we were talking to a dance and theater alum who's a lawyer in Georgia. And he talked about how, you know, whether it's a presentation or a meeting with an important client or, you know, being in that courtroom, which I don't think he does, but I could be wrong. You know, you put on this persona and this confidence, and you need to know the audience, even if it's just one person. And it helps to relate to the individuals, to empathize, to articulate your point. So I think that's huge. And I think you already are doing that in your career, whether it was while you were, you know, volunteering with the Duchesne Center or with the interning or even your community theater, if there's someone younger than you or, you know, I would say like the recent retiree who wants to tap into this interest that they've had but has never been nourished, that you're able to say, hey, come walk with me, talk with me, I'll help you. And I think that is the influence that you've talked about. Like, there's no, hey, Gabby, here's this great piece of advice. It's been a conversation where you've taken what you've needed at that moment or reflected upon it. And I think that's been absolutely clear in your conversation thus far. And I hope that is something that students take away, is that it doesn't have to be like a giant billboard flashing saying, hey, do this, or here's this. Right. It's that thing that, you know, you kind of are walking home or driving home or whatever, and you're like, huh, makes you think.
Absolutely. So much of what you said has been so great, and I can totally relate to. And then the other question is, what skills would you say are necessary for success today in the world of drama therapy? I know you mentioned being very self-reflective, mm-hmm. And then, you know, so allowing others to reflect with you. But if you could expand upon that, that would be great. And how do you think maybe the requirements within the field are changing?
I feel like that's such a extremely relevant question, because they're changing even before my eyes. But I would say prior to the COVID-19 pandemic, in the fall semester, so much of what we were learning and talking about, especially in the drama therapy specific classes, like I mentioned, and like Olivia reminded about, it's a ton of self-reflection, because if you don't know yourself and the things that trouble you, the things that you hold on to from your past, if you're not aware of those things and you bring them into the therapy space, it's not beneficial for your clients, for the people that you end up working with, because it becomes this subconscious like thing that's, it's the elephant in the room almost. And so a big thing that has been emphasized in my program and that we're always talking about and processing together is knowing ourselves first as people before we can even begin talking with people who need that help from us. And so it's sort of this cyclical process of how can I help you find yourself if I have not yet found myself? You know, that's always a moving process too. So even as I am an intern right now, there's still stuff about me that I haven't quite sussed out, but I'm aware of these things. And so if I have this awareness, I can put it somewhere else. I can take that piece of me and sort of put it on a shelf while I'm engaging with a client. So it's not affecting our relationship. It's still part of me. I haven't thrown it away, but it's not infiltrating our space together. So it's not welcome in the bubble.
I love that. Not welcome in the bubble. I'm feeling that.
Right. It is like a bubble. Being in the therapy space is extremely like a bubble. It's a safe bubble because we make it safe together. And so I think that's probably the most important thing to note about drama therapy and therapy in general. If anyone's going to become a therapist, it's something that is important to do. The drama therapy program is special in that we do it all the time. I had a class with some students who are in the mental health and counseling program. So it's a non-specified, it's just, you know, a standard mental health counseling, and whatever specificity goes into that is in the future. But we learned from them that in their classes, they don't really talk that closely about feelings and about their personal histories. And I think that's unique to drama therapy and the other arts therapies, that so much of this internal discovery happens in order to become a practitioner. But I think it's so vital, because then if you get rid of your junk and put it somewhere that's not the therapy space, it's so helpful. But I think it also speaks to the personable relation, like the such closeness in drama therapy that doesn't really happen in a traditional therapy space. And I think another important skill for becoming a drama therapist specifically is having some kind of arts in your life. You know, you don't have to be a professional actor and have studied scene study and acting and acting history, but it's such a big part of it that if you cannot tap into that creativity and if you cannot find that artist within you, it just kind of flattens the relationship. It flattens the work, because we deal a lot in metaphor and a lot in, the group as therapeutic tool and all of these different things that come from drama, like ensemble and like metaphor. There's so much metaphor foreign theater and light. If you can't, you know, take on a role, if you can't role play with a client, it's all of these things that can hamper your ability to utilize drama therapy as a tool. So I think that's really important as well, to be established in some kind of art, just to have a basic understanding of it.
So one of my questions was going to be, let's pretend I'm much younger than I am. So I'm a first year college student, undeclared, sitting, watching this back. What would you recommend me to do in order to kind of dip my toe in the drama therapy waters before diving in and maybe declaring a major in dance and theater or psychology? You know, how do I test those waters without committing completely?
Like I mentioned, if a person could take, you know, just a basic acting class, who learn the elements, the tenets of theater, of acting, that's already a huge start. I think for sure on the psychology route, taking a, you know, psych 101 course is very important, because while I've been doing a lot of arts-based and, you know, drama therapy classes, I have also been taking a ton of applied psychology courses. I took abnormal psychology and I took a group dynamics class, which, you know, teaches about how people engage in a group together, which is, you know, also something that you learn in a theater class, but this was more so from a human interaction point of view. And if we put 12 people in a circle and tell them to talk, what's going to happen? And all of the different stages of that sit down and talk, which was fascinating to see from within the bubble. So I would say, you know, both of those things of, if you want to go into an arts-based therapy, absolutely take a class that's in that art modality, because, you know, I just took drama classes because I wanted to be an actor and then drama therapist. So all of my drama background really feeds into that. But if you want to be a music therapist or an art therapist or a dance therapist, which is available at Manhattanville, that is a track. I had a lot of dance therapy friends. If you want to do any of those modalities, any of those creative arts therapies, it's really important that you are tapped into that modality and that artistic background, because it's going to be your whole craft. It's going to be your whole tool. And so if you don't have a handle on it, then it can just make things tricky. But also a psychology background of any kind is also extremely huge, because being a therapist of any kind requires an understanding of human beings and an understanding of the intricacies of the human mind and the human soul, and just like the emotions and how basically the 360 experience of being a person shows up in the therapy space. And so it's not just about what a person says. It's not just about what a person, you know, presents as. It's basically from the minute they're born, things are affecting them as a person. And so the psychology classes help to inform that experience and to build that understanding of, okay, this person came in saying that they feel depressed, but there's like a myriad of ways that they actually could be. And so drama therapy really sets a strong foundation of getting to, you know, the cores of people scientifically, psychologically, and dramatically. You know, we always say, how is a patient and a client performing today? What part of their diagnosis is performing with us today? And that could mean a thousand different things. And so I think the psychology and the arts are, you know, for the undecided student, if you're even curious, certainly dip your toes in there.
So Gabby, I'm going to bring you briefly back to your life at Manhattanville.
Sure.
If you had to do it all over again, would you change anything or do anything differently while you're at Manhattanville?
I don't know. Maybe there's some like tiny details I would switch just to make things a little bit easier. But, you know, I think as an emerging adult, I think I was making all of the choices that I needed to, especially academically. And I think that's because of the guidance of my educators and my advisors at the school that helped me make choices I was happy with and comfortable with. So I think in terms of anything big, I probably wouldn't change anything, because I think it all was for something, and it just fed my experience so well that it's useful somewhere. And it happened for a reason. It's like such a cliche to say that, but it's like for my life, it's true. I think despite, you know, having moments where I was like, I don't really like what's happening right now. But if I looked back at it in the grand scheme of things, it fits the puzzle somehow as a piece in the scheme. And I think, I think if I changed anything, it would just throw things on its side and I would have to start changing other things. And then it would not be my journey anymore. And so I think I can say from my experience that my journey had missteps, but I think they were the right missteps.
And then our last question for you, are there any resources, books or podcasts that you would recommend to our students that might be interested in dance therapy, or just any resources, you know, that you found helpful in your journey so far?
So when I was applying to NYU, I had to you know, be familiar with some pieces of literature in drama therapy. And now, even as a student, I've read so many pieces. I feel like if anyone wants to, you know, kind of start investigating into drama therapy, there are a ton of books out there written by the founders. Like when I was applying, I read, it's a book called The Couch and the Stage by Robert Landy. He was the person who founded the program at NYU. So he's one of the pioneers of drama therapy. And I would also say, if anyone is, I had a very strong interest in trauma work within the realm of drama therapy. So if anyone is interested in drama therapy's work with trauma, it's called Trauma-Informed Drama Therapy. And that was edited and partially written by Dr. Nisha Sajnani. So that is an incredible tool. It's basically all the drama therapists in the field who work with trauma and who have invented protocols and different ways of working with it in the field. So it's, you know, each chapter is written by a different voice, and they are voices I utilize in my papers all the time and have met personally sometimes. And so I would recommend that book as well. and really anything in the drama therapy field, because it's so new. So most of the work is being written by the founders and people who have graduated my program and the other programs in North America. So it's all relevant information, even, you know, the stuff that was written 40 years ago, because it's kind of the basis. So it might not be like relevant because of the, you know, time period and the people in it. But the ideas are important because they are the guiding principles. And I think, you know, anything that gets Googled about drama therapy is vital to read. It's all very important. So I can recommend it all right now as a student who has pretty much read it all.
And I love that you go to Google. We are avid fans of Googling information, but it's really true. Like, I think drama therapy is so new, and I think pieces have been going on for a really long time, but there was no title and there were no parameters. And now that, you know, ideas are now fully formed and there's parameters and there's working within. And I, you know, definitely have Nisha sign that book. I think that's going to be amazing.
Yeah.
But I love how engrossed you are in this. And I think your experience with your master's program is a testament to you go on with your, you know, your studies or your master's programs when you're really invested. And I commend you for taking that time and going through those survival jobs and recognizing where you wanted to step forward to thrive. You know, I think how you're talking about your time at NYU and how you're talking about Nisha, like, I now want to meet all of your professors and I want to sit in the class audit just to listen. You know, when you said, she says hello and you feel it and it resonates with you. I was like, I want that. I'll go to that. I don't think I'd be a good drama therapist, but mainly because I have no idea. I think for someone who has started in September and has done all of this throughout COVID and you haven't lost momentum and you haven't lost any kind of steam, I'm really excited to see where you go on with your career and see how you create this next gen of drama therapy. And I'm so excited.
Yeah. And I think that's important to note. I forgot to emphasize that because, you know, I feel like the field right now looks a little more dubious than it did before based on the telehealth element. I've been doing internships purely on telehealth. My classes have been virtual since March. And so I want to call out that you pointed out, you know, it's very staying motivated within the pandemic. And to call back Nisha, honestly, Nisha was what kept me around because she has been so wise and such a tool. And so I want to say, because we even have our first year cohort coming in behind us and they're entering the program with all of this digital the elements tied into it. And we always say my cohort's kind of special because we learned it while in it. And so the field shifted while we were in the midst of learning it. And so we have sort of an advantage here that I'm curious as to how that's going to affect the cohort right behind me, because they're not very far behind, but they almost missed out. Like, the things that my class and I and my professors and I pretty much invented all happened in this collaborative laboratory type of space. And now the first year cohort behind us is kind of going to be the guinea pig as to how that works when it's been planned, rather than this is just us improvising class today because we were supposed to do this in-person thing that is now on Zoom and it's totally different. And so I think, in a word of recommendation to anyone who is inspired to look into drama therapy from this talk or has been thinking about it and wants to find out more about it, to not be deterred by the telehealth element of it. It seems really scary. For me, it's extremely confusing because I learned so much in person and then had to basically figure out how to translate that to the screen, because it's, one might think you have to work harder on the screen, but you actually can do less because of the fact that time feels like 75% of what you have on the screen, that like an hour is actually 45 minutes, that, you know, you're in this little box. And so something that might have been huge and embodied in the space is actually really tiny in your little square on the Zoom call or the FaceTime call or anything like that. And so I encourage students who are curious about it now to stay curious, because it's not going away. If anything, think drama therapy is blossoming. It just grew another arm in the form of telehealth because nobody had really been doing it intentionally. It was just another option. And now there's all of this actual content that's been generated by the field and all of this new research that I think has been vital to the survival of drama therapy and the arts therapies throughout the pandemic. And so I encourage future students to lean into that.
I love it. And I think that's actually a perfect example of kind of leaning into it. So you were, I mean, the term, like you're building the plane as you're flying it. Mm-hmm. But I really do think drama therapy is going to come into play, especially with the younger kids, you know, the kids that have integrated into school and that was traumatizing. And now they're home and that's traumatic because they want to go outside. They can see the playground, but they can't touch the playground. And then to go back into a classroom where there's masks and there's plexiglass and depending on how old they are, they might not understand what that means. So I really think that the drama therapy, the dance therapy, the art therapy, we're going to see blossom, especially for these younger individuals that might not have the words to describe what they're going through, but they can still emote it in different ways. So I'm so excited to see, again, where you go, how you flourish, how you thrive. And I thank you so much for sharing your story. I thank you so much for being in this industry and learning it during all of this, because let's talk about earning your stripes. Yeah, you've earned them. You've done it. And I just am so appreciative. And I thank you so much, Gabby. I keep in touch with us. We want to know all the amazing things that you're doing, how we can help you, and how we can continue to pay it forward.
Absolutely. For sure.
Thank you so much, Gabby. Take care.
So,
much
so good
for
to see
me.
You again.
You
Gabby.
Too.
Stay healthy, stay happy, stay safe.
You
keep
as
it
well.
Going. All right. Have a great one.
Thank you.